Hello, this is Scott Thielman, Superintendent of the Buffalo-Hanover-Montrose School District. I'm recording this presentation today to provide additional information regarding the November 6, 2018 operating referendum. In July of 2018, the school board for the Buffalo-Hanover-Montrose School District passed a resolution calling for an operating referendum, and the election will be held on November 6, 2018. The district wants to continue to lower class sizes, address school safety through personnel and infrastructure, expand middle school opportunities, and address the special education funding deficit. The state and federal government have not been keeping up with the costs of special education, and the state recognizes its inability to keep up with the costs, the rising costs of education and special education. Now, that was not always the case. When school districts called for operating referendums in the past, it was mainly to include extras or something that a community wanted to offer that another community didn't have or that the general education funding couldn't afford, like a language immersion program or a symphonic orchestra program, something along those lines. But now more and more school districts are having to go to the community and parents to ask for support in the case of an operating referendum. Another reason that the school board passed the resolution calling for an operating referendum is because the district has begun to spend down its fund balance, its savings account. The district did a great job in holding the line on the fund balance and actually increasing it slightly in anticipation that it would spend it down. And now we're to that point. For 17-18 school year, the district dipped into the fund balance by $1.3 million. The school board intentionally passed a $2.8 million deficit going into the 18-19 school year. The district has a fund balance policy and it targets 8 to 12%. Currently, the fund balance is projected to drop below 8% by 2020. Some folks have asked me over time, you know, aren't you getting new money? Aren't you getting money every year? That point is true. We have. And in this case, for the fiscal year 19, which is the 18-19 school year, the district received 2% increase in funding. But at the same time, as of July of 2018, the CPI, the Consumer Price Index, which really judges or keeps track of inflation, has increased 2.9%. We know that it's not going to end at 2.9% by the end of December. And looking back at a history of our district, the last time we had a voter-approved increase in the operating referendum was in 2002. So I went back and looked at CPI over that time. And from 2002 to the school year 17-18, CPI, Consumer Price Index, went up 33.5%, while at the same time, districts did get additional funding, but 25.1% of additional funding. That's a difference of 8.4%. And we know that inflation has a big impact on school districts and the funding and the programming that we can allow or offer our students and class sizes that we can have in classrooms. So what we're seeing more and more now in the state of Minnesota is that school districts are going out for operating referendums just to meet the basic needs of the funding each and every year. And some people have asked, well, why such a big increase? We are asking for $950 per pupil unit. The increase comes because we haven't had any increase in 16 years since 2002. But we did ask the community to support an increase in 2007 and in 2008. And at that time, the community said no. And the district took that answer and cut $3 million from the budget, cut 40 teachers, other administrators, and support staff. And when looking at the current ask to be able to help reduce class sizes, address school safety through personnel and infrastructure, expand middle school opportunities, and address special education funding deficit, what we find is that we're still, even with this increase, and if the voters were to approve the increase, we're still below the state average for general education revenue. So I'd like to take the next couple of minutes and just talk to some of the goals and the targets that the school board has identified in the upcoming operating referendum. One is to reduce class sizes. And by that, we're talking about reducing class sizes, elementary and secondary. At elementary, we target class sizes of 22 or less in kindergarten, 24 or less for first and second graders, 26 or less in third grade, and 28 or less in fourth and fifth grade. In middle school, we target any classes above 30. What we're finding, though, is that we're unable to meet those targets. And what it does not include currently is what we've been trying to do over the past 9 years. This is my ninth year with the school board, or excuse me, with the school district. And in that time, we have been able to make some investment in trying to reduce class sizes. As I mentioned earlier, the board cut $3 million from the budget and cut 40 teachers. Since then, we've been able to add some teachers back, two in 2012 to the contingency, and those were just for hotspots throughout the system where we had very large class sizes. In 2013, the school district was able to add six positions using some one-time stimulus dollars from the recession. And in 2015, the district received some location equity revenue and were allowed to keep the six positions that they had previously held to and add six more in 2015. In 2016, we were only able to add a half a FTE. In 2018, we added two more FTEs as a board initiative to reduce class sizes. Now, that doesn't even include the first grade class in Hanover that we had to add in August due to large class sizes. And in Northwinds, we added another section of kindergarten as open house at the end of August. We were still having parents register students, and we still had a couple of since then. And it doesn't also include the Montrose Elementary fourth grade class that we just added recently due to the large class sizes of 29 in Montrose. So all of those pieces we're trying to maintain and continue to commit to in the future. Again, all of this does not even include the added teachers and ESPs or paraprofessionals that we had to add for special education. Special education budget continues to grow based on need and based on student programming that is required by the state and federal government. So we've added teachers, we've added paraprofessionals over time, and that's because a parent moves into our community and they have a child who has needs. It could be a quadriplegic, it could be someone with needs that are less severe, but we are obligated to provide the programming for those parents or for those students when they join the district. And those costs continue to rise each and every year. When we talk about adding or addressing school safety through personnel and infrastructure, we're primarily talking about addressing student mental health needs. And what we're talking about there are social workers, folks that needed to help our students and address those mental health needs in the classroom. Now, we know that we can help identify more of those needs based on smaller class sizes, because teachers have relationships with students, and then we can direct those students to the help that they need, whether it might be psychologists, school counselors, social workers, whatever it happens to be. We will be able to make those investments. And just as when I'm talking about class sizes and reducing class sizes, we're not saying that we're going to hire 10 teachers for the high school or 8 teachers for Hanover Elementary. We're going to continue to use the funds judiciously throughout the district and make those investments as necessary to meet those targets or actually go below those targets that we currently have and get back to the 2000, the class sizes that we had before the 2007-2008 cuts. The same is true with mental health professionals. We're not saying that we're going to hire 10 counselors or 6 social workers. We're going to make those investments judiciously. We lower class sizes. We know how to target the intervention or redirect services for those students. Those are what we're going to, how we're going to address those areas. Just because we always have fluctuating enrollment, we don't know the students that are coming in and the needs on a yearly and annual basis. Some people are also wondering, well, why do we need to address infrastructure needs? Didn't we just have a bond? Yes, we did. We had a building bond that we targeted some areas at that time, like putting a new entry at Hanover Elementary and a new entry at Tatonka Elementary and a new entry at Discovery Elementary. And we were making those investments because 5 years ago, we thought that was the best thing to do. Things have changed, times have changed, and expectations have changed from parents and community members as well as students. And just last March, we had an event where students were going to walk out of school in protest of school safety. And Mr. Mischke, our high school principal, worked with students, and they actually had a walk in. And they walked into the gymnasium. They had 17-minute program. They had 17 seconds of silence. But at the end of the day, we have a bison time at the high school, and that's 20 minutes where students can get individual attention and need address their needs with built within the schedule. But Mr. Mischke invited our sheriff and our chief of police from Buffalo, as well as Marion O'Neill, Senator Bruce Anderson. We had school board members there, myself, and Mr. Mischke, and we answered questions from students that they had regarding safety and security. And after that question and answer session, I had a student walk up to me and ask me about school safety, and it was a deaf, hard of hearing student. And she indicated that she could not hear announcements when she was in the hall or in the cafeteria or large spaces. I was wondering if there was a light or a system that had a light indicator that it was a visual in cases where we were in a crisis or a lockdown situation. I didn't even know if that was possible. Talking to our directors of buildings and grounds, he indicated, yes, that is a possibility. And so that is something that we're looking at investing in. Now, some people might be saying, well, didn't the state just set aside $25 million for safety and security? They did. In fact, they set aside $12.5 million for the 11-county metro area, and Buffalo is part of that 11-county metro area. And then they set aside $12.5 million for all the other counties in the state of Minnesota. Out of that $25 million request, they didn't ask for a request by district. They indicated that they wanted submissions by school. And so the state received, out of the $25 million grant set aside, they received $250 million worth of requests. We submitted $1.3 million worth of requests, and that was just on our high priority because the state indicated that it could be in high priority, middle, medium priority, or low priority, We only indicated the high priority needs, and each facility was capped at an amount that it could not exceed. So we submitted our needs, we submitted to the state, and we had one school identified, and that was Montrose Elementary, and they are going to fund $50,000 worth of improvements at Montrose. But it's going to be very hard to address Montrose needs when we are having to do the same thing at all of our buildings. So we're working through that whole process. But I want to get back to some of the things that we make an investment in. We're looking at 3M window film for the first floor of every single building in the district. We're looking for door indicators where we have the ability to tell if a door is open. Sometimes in the spring, in the fall, when windows are open in the building, the doors are blowing open because of the imbalance in the air pressure within that building. We don't know sometimes when those doors are open. So this would give us an indicator system where we would know if any door is open and we could address it at that time. So those are just a few of those pieces that we're looking at addressing. And then the other part is safety protocol and procedures. We're continually looking at making an investment in safety protocol and procedures. We've had Homeland Security come in and speak to our safety committee, as well as the county sheriff's department and Buffalo Police Department. We have folks that are always looking to make improvements in lockdown protocol. We want to make investments in student and staff training. And then we're also looking for things like an app that would have classroom rosters for our teachers, would work through Wi-Fi, and would also be able to notify parents. Because we know in a crisis situation, cell towers are the first ones to crash. So we're looking at all of those types of things when we make these investments. And again, I can't reiterate enough about the strong adult-student relationships that are needed, and the investment that we can have in class sizes also help provide a safer environment in the schools. Now, some folks are asking about, what are we talking about with school schedules at the middle school? Well, Mr. Lubin has been looking at providing opportunities for students for the last 6 years, and in earnest the last 3 years, and looking at trying to personalize and individualize the opportunities and the investments that we're making in school at the middle school level. When we talk about personalize and individualize, we do that all the time at elementary. We don't have a bell schedule. We have math, reading, social studies, science, and other subjects built within the day, but there's no bell schedule. So when an elementary teacher sits down with their reading group, they work with them one-on-one or in small groups where we can address remediation or intervention with a student in reading or math. It's fluid. The students are in and out of those groups at all times. When we get to the middle school, we don't have that opportunity. We offer a 6-period day. It's 4 periods where the block of 4 periods where we have English, math, social studies, science, and then we have the required classes, music, physical education, we have art, communications, technology, all of those where students really don't have a choice until they're 8th grade. And then it's a kind of a forced choice. And we're looking at providing an opportunity within that schedule where we can provide intervention and remediation as well as enrichment. I'm going to focus just for a minute on the intervention remediation. Currently, when a student has difficulty in reading or math, we're pulling those students out of their English class or their social studies class or their phys-ed physical education class or music class. We don't have a time built within that schedule to provide intervention or remediation. And quite frankly, it's stigmatizing for those kids. And Mr. Lubin hasn't found a better way to address it. And this schedule that he's devised with his staff are going to be able to provide those opportunities. The other piece is really the student choice and giving kids opportunity to explore outside of the six period day, the mandatory four core subjects, and then the mandatory other subjects that students have. But we'd like to expand that and provide students opportunities for electives like robotics or Project Lead the Way with engineering or world languages, get a sampling of French or German or Spanish that we offer in the high school. It could be an expansion of tech ed courses or business ed courses. We have a very strong agricultural program, and they've been asking to come into or offer classes at the middle school with ag and FFA. All of those are great opportunities, and we'd like to do that, but it's hard to do without having a different, well, impossible to do without having a different schedule. And we also know that teacher collaboration and working together to review student work and look reviewing instructional practices help improve student performance. So what do we mean by providing the intervention and remediation within the day? You're looking at a slide right now where the student who has the intervention or remediation will not be taken out of one of their core subject classes. Now, these electives and intervention periods can be anywhere within, this is just a sample mock-up of a schedule that Mr. Lubin is looking at. But within this schedule, we can offer the intervention or the remediation for the students without being stigmatized, where the classmates are asking, why are you leaving class right now? Here, you're going to have a period built within the day. And what's more important is that they're still going to have an elective of their choice. Currently, that wouldn't have been possible. So now we have an opportunity for students to have electives within the day and intervention and remediation built within the day to address their needs. And then here's another example of the modified block schedule so that you can see what students would be able to access during the day. Those classes, again, would be able to expand their current opportunities, but it won't happen without more staff. And Mr. Lubin has indicated that it's about 7 staff members to have the expanded middle school opportunities and to have the new schedule. The last piece that we're talking about is the state and federal funding deficits for special education. It happens year after year, and this is my 17th year as a superintendent. I've lobbied at the Capitol, met with our state legislative representatives. I'm actually a past president with the Minnesota Association of School Administrators. That was part of our legislative platform. I'm on the National Governing Board for superintendents, and we lobby at the in Washington, D.C. They fly us out, and we meet with all of our Minnesota congressional members and our two state senators to talk about special education funding. Special education funding came about with Public Law 94-142 in 1974 and was reauthorized as IDEA, Individuals with Disabilities Education Act. It has not been reauthorized with the new funding. They know that they have a problem with it, and it just keeps getting larger. With Public Law 94-142 or IDEA, state and federal governments have required programming for students from birth to 21. And in the home, we provide services from for students who are from age birth to 2 that are educationally related services, whether it's occupational therapy, physical therapy, speech language therapy. We go to the home and provide those services. And then at from ages 3 to 5, they're integrated and brought into the school system and into the school buildings. And we provide programming here in the buildings. And then from kindergarten through 12th grade, they're integrated into the classrooms as determined by their individual education plan. And we serve them through their 12th grade. Some students are need transition services beyond 12th grade, and we provide those services by law till their 22nd birthday through 21. And those are students who are serviced in our Pride program, where they may be working in a local business or functional industries. They may be living at home for the rest of their life or a group home, whatever the circumstances, but we provide those services, and they're needed services, not only for the 18 to 21 year old from birth to 21. We are committed to providing great services, and we do that each and every year. Currently, when I created this PowerPoint presentation, our special education deficit was $760 per pupil unit, or $4.8 million. That has now grown by $1.1 million. I just received that report about 3 weeks ago, and it is $5.9 million on an annual basis. So when, again, folks are asking why so much, you can see that pressures, we just lost a $1.1 million of the dollars that we were going to use to help invest in reducing class sizes, in addressing school safety, and the middle school opportunities. The current request is for $950, a net change. It's to revoke the current levy of $119.87. Now, that was left over from the 2000 and 2002 levies. We renewed those in 2009 and 2011, and there were we did not receive an increase in those operating referendums. And so we're looking at actually having a change for the first time in 16 years. Again, the community voted no in 07 and 08. We made cuts accordingly. This funding that we're asking for does not will not be taxed on agricultural property other than the house, garage, and 1 acre, their homestead. And then seasonal recreational property or cabins are not included in this proposal either. So the increase, if it were to pass in November, will not be given to the school district next school year. Because it goes on the tax rolls in May and are collected in May and October, and it won't come to us until the year 2020. So as we said, or I have said over this presentation, that we're looking to continue to lower class sizes and keep the investments that we currently have made into class, reducing class sizes, make an investment in safety and security through addressing mental health issues and needs, and as well as making some improvements in the infrastructure of the school district, expanding middle school opportunities, meaning a middle school new schedule, and addressing the special education funding deficit. Just as a reminder that we are spending down our fund balance. We cannot continue to spend down the fund balance and any longer without having to make cuts and make commitments. And just as another point of information, the district has made these investments in reducing class sizes, but we've also made investments at the high school and offering college level classes to high school students. In the last report that I received from Mr. Mischke, our high school principal at Buffalo High School, there was an indication that we saved parents $1.8 million in tuition costs that students would have been charged had they gone to a college and attended college after high school. Our investment and our relationships with the University of Minnesota, Southwest Minnesota State, St. Cloud State, and now our new partners at North Hennepin Community College and Hennepin Technical College give us the ability to offer classes to a wider variety of students, not just the top 10% of a class or top quartile. Now we can offer them to the top 70% of a class. And our relationship with Hennepin Technical College will now give students the opportunity to attend any technical college in the state of Minnesota and have their credits transfer with them as they attend those technical colleges. Again, we have looked at CPI and the cost of or the inflation pressures that school districts have received, and especially with the Buffalo-Hanover-Montrose school district. Our fund balance target is going to dip below 8% by 2020. And the levy request that we're asking for is still, even though it's $950, is still below, the school district will still be below the state average in general education revenue. If you have any further questions, you can call 763-682-0877 or email us at election@bhmschools.org. All of this information is on our website at www.bhmschools.org. I'd be willing to go out and speak to any community member, and no group is too small. We still have a public forum that will be held on the 23rd at 6:30 in the school district's boardroom, and then at Montrose Elementary School on the 25th at 6:30. And I'll also be attending a couple other public forums in the community, like the Montrose City Council meeting. If you have any questions, again, please feel free to give us a call. I look forward to hearing from you in the future. Have a great day.